Belinda presents this unabridged recording of Grimoire, written by Kim Wilkins and read by Casey Withoos. This book is lovingly inscribed to Princess Caitlin. Acknowledgements. I wish to acknowledge the following for their help and support. Selwa Anthony, as always, has been a rock, but a very gentle and loving one. Kirsten McDermott has been an advisor, a co-conspirator, and a friend on my creative journey. Janine Haig, I am forever in your debt. Merci to Nicole Ruckles for providing me with a story, and Mr. Buckman, it's all true. Charles Samuel in Jerusalem and Dr. Wally Wood in the Anatomy Department, University of Queensland, provided invaluable assistance with my research. Claude and Polly were fantastic lap warmers on cold, inspirationless days. Mirko Ruckles has made more cups of frustration-easing tea than I care to count, and has always reminded me tenderly that one bad writing day does not mean I've lost it forever. Others I would like to thank include my teachers at the University of Queensland and my friends, especially Drew Whitehead, Davin Patterson, Dansix Johnson, Boris Ruckles, Alison Gallagher, and, of course, my beloved mother and brother, who love me even though I continue to bring the family name into disrepute. Most of all, for this book, however, I wish to acknowledge a debt to Kate Morton, who, with her love and her irrepressible vivacity, has made me discover parts of myself that I had forgotten in adolescence. For all the times we've dressed as fairy princesses, for all the pizza and red wine we've consumed, for all the celebrity-obsessed TV and magazines we've devoured, for all the creepy stories we've told or read to each other, and for animating my imaginative life with childlike energy, this book can only be dedicated to her. Let love clasp grief, lest both be drowned. Let darkness keep her raven gloss, us sweeter to be drunk with loss, to dance with death, to beat the ground. Then that the victor ours should scorn the long result of love and boast, behold the man that loved and lost, but all he was is overworn. Alfred, Lord Tennyson. I gotta keep moving. I gotta keep moving. There's a hellhound on my trail. Robert Johnson. Prologue, 1867. P.C. Hallam was a long way from his beat. The bitter smell of the Thames, the dark shadows leaping in the gaslight, the wharf hands swearing as they loaded the crate onto the spar. A stark contrast to the fashionable, genteel streets of Faraday Square and Milton Close, the new estates which are usually policed. Perhaps it wasn't such a good idea to be down here at the docks, huddling in the gloom out of uniform. But he had to be sure. "Easy! Easy!" called a foreman from the boat, a 100-foot bark headed for the colonies. The crate threatened to spin off the hook, then hovered over the wharf as it swung on the derrick to the deck. It cast a block of shadows which momentarily darkened the faces of the workers. Men on the boat were guiding it into the cargo hull. The chill night air chafed Hallam's cheeks, and he rubbed his gloved hands together. How strange that he should be pining for the comfort of his beat when it was there that he had experienced the garish nightmare that continued to haunt him. He shuddered as, once more, the sickening vision squirmed its way into his reluctant memory. It had been a Thursday evening, brisk but not too cold. The fog was rolling in from the evening, and a young couple had stopped to ask him directions. He had just sent them on their way when he had heard screams from 13 Milton Close. Peter Owling, the resident, was a well-known eccentric, usually dressed in flamboyantly coloured silks, which drew attention to his obesity. Hallam had run up the stairs and hammered on the door. No response, only a loud sobbing. He broke the window in the door and fumbled for the lock on the inside, burst in, and followed the sound of the voice until he came to Owling's opulent dining room, decorated lavishly with deep red wallpaper, gilt-edged picture frames, an extravagant chandelier. And there, the nightmare. It looked as though guests had been expected for dinner. The dining table was heaving under the weight of dishes. A ham, a roast turkey, bowls of cooked vegetables, tarts, bottles of wine. And in the centre of it, illuminated by the dim, flickering candlelight, the dead, naked body of Peter Owling. Hallam had scanned the room. The sobbing came from a boy in the corner, Christian, Owling's young friend. He was about 17, a beautiful lad with an angel's face, and the target of a lot of gossip about the exact nature of his relationship with Owling. "My God, what happened here?" Hallam asked, though he didn't really expect an answer. It was well known that Christian was a mute. Christian sobbed, pointing senselessly towards the body. Hallam approached the dining table. Owling's massive white belly was crisscrossed with deep, thin lines of gore, as though some cruelly fine, sharp instrument had been used to inscribe a message of hate in the pallid flesh. The back of his head, Hallam could see, was mashed and bloody, as though he'd been slammed onto the table with great force. And lying on his chest, pinned there with a dagger which had clearly been driven into his heart, was a book. Or rather, a section torn from a book. Dark blood dribbled in sticky drops off the table and pooled on the floor. "Dear Lord," Hallam muttered. "Next time he will destroy us all." Hallam spun around. The boy had spoken. He stared in astonishment at the lad, silent for years as far as he knew. Was it the shock that had given him back his power of speech? "What happened here, Christian? Who did this?" "Next time he will destroy us all." "Did you do this?" But as soon as the question left his lips, Hallam knew that Christian could not be responsible. Owling was all the boy had. "Next time, you're not making sense, lad." Then a thin, keening wail as the boy turned his tear-stained face heavenwards and lapsed again into mournful sobbing. "Next time he will destroy us all!" Hallam shook his head to clear it of the visions. The last crate of books was being lifted onto the bark. Owling's books. He had been nearly insolvent because of the lavish lifestyle he had led, and he had owed a rich banking family, the Humberstones, a fortune. They had emptied his home as part payment. And in one of those crates was the book that had been pinned to Owling's chest. Hallam knew for sure because he had put it in the crate. He had seen enough of the pages to know what kind of book it was. Backwards writing and invocations, impossibly complicated drawings of circles embellished with ancient languages, pentagrams and hexagrams. Something unholy. Something he wanted as far away from London, from himself, as possible. And no doubt it was the unholy magic that stopped the thing from burning when he and two other constables had set fire to it in an attempt to destroy it. Owling's front door hadn't yet been fixed, so it had been easy to break in, to jam the thing in one of the crates between the other books, send it to the colonies where it could do no harm. Because next time... A scream broke through the rimy night air, and Hallam turned to see a pale figure approaching in the dark, running down the pier as though the devil were on his tail. Christian. His white face was contorted in terror. His long black hair flowed behind him. "No! No!" the lad screamed as he pelted towards the bark. "Christian!" Hallam called, stepping out to stop him. Christian pushed him out of the way and made to run up the gangway and onto the boat. The commotion had caused confusion among the handlers. The last crate had already been let off the derrick, and the spar was swinging back over to the dock. Hallam felt his body tense as he saw what was going to happen. Christian's head collided with the hook. There was a spurt of blood as the heavy iron crushed into his temple. The men were rushing towards him, but he staggered a few paces, then plunged unconscious off the gangway and into the black water. Hallam turned his back on the ensuing commotion. He knew they would not find the boy before he drowned, not in the murky depths between the wharf and the boat. Perhaps his sad, grey body would be pulled from the water in a day or two, floating to the surface after the fish had already feasted on its extremities. Perhaps it would never rise, but stay eternally, like a pathetic secret, in the silent depths. Hallam sat heavily on the edge of the dock. He waited all through the evening, shivering in the bleak October wind, watching the half-hearted rescue attempts from his place in the shadows. He only felt he could breathe again when the bark finally drew away and set sail for Australia. The ends of the earth. Then he pulled himself to his feet and began the long walk home. He shoved his hands into his coat pockets and huddled deeper into the warm material. Poor Christian. A second victim of Owling's unholy dabbling. Hallam shuddered as he remembered the strange, empty look in the boy's eyes when he'd been released from police custody after questioning. Half mad with grief and shock, he had relapsed into his dumbstruck ways, never telling what had happened to Owling. But then, Hallam wasn't really sure he wanted to know. Chapter 1. The pleasure was exquisite. Hot, moist trails of bliss in arcs and spirals on her skin. Deeper, deeper. She groaned in her sleep. The featherlight touch of warm fingers on her thighs. Soft, slow, creeping boldly upwards, gathering intensity. Holly shuddered, then woke with a gasp. For a moment she was disoriented, couldn't remember where she was. The lamp over her desk sent the shadows huddling back into their corners. She was alone in her office at the college. It was very late, and she had just had an orgasm while dozing over a book. Great, she muttered, wet dreams like a teenage boy. She swiveled round on her chair. There were two other desks as well as her own in the office. One was for Prudence, the aloof, purple-haired girl whom she had met briefly this afternoon. The other was for somebody called Justin, who hadn't yet arrived at the college. Holly checked her watch and thought about going home. Her heart sank. Another sleepless night battling with the bugs and the cold drafts, with the musty smell of the place and the noisy plumbing. She berated herself once again for not inspecting before she signed the lease. It was just that she'd been in such a hurry, so eager to find a place, any place, so excited about her scholarship. So desperate to be away from Daybrook and start a new life. A shadow seemed to move on the periphery of her vision. She turned quickly but saw nothing. "Afraid of the dark, Holly?" she said aloud, and her voice sounded very hollow in the empty room. It was the dream that had spooked her. Her imaginary lover's touch had seemed so real. Yes, definitely time to go home. She leaned over to switch off her study lamp, then paused, realising that it would plunge her into total darkness. Surely it wouldn't matter if she left the light on overnight. Her keys jangled in her pocket as she pulled her jacket on. The sound comforted her, broke the silence. She eyed the telephone and thought about calling a cab. Ridiculous, it was only 2 blocks home and only 9 o'clock. Hardly the witching hour. The hallway was dark, and Holly had to stand still for a few moments while her eyes adjusted. Every other sane student at the college must have gone home hours ago. The wonderful smell of the place, old wood and dusty books, cheered her a little. So she had left behind her family, her friends, a secure job and a comfortable home, to live in a bug-infested flat behind somebody's house. What did it matter when she had this opportunity to start her master's in Victorian literature at one of the most elite institutions in the Southern Hemisphere? She locked the office behind her and headed for the stair tower, bounding down the steps 2 at a time to the front door. A muted red light from the Coke machine in the cafeteria glowed in the darkness. The door handle was cool under her touch as she pushed it to let herself out. It locked behind her with a thud, and she emerged into the reassuring glow of security lights over the front entrance. The two ancient fig trees that stood sentinel on either side of the front path.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.